Hello, my name is Jenelle Hall and I'm a clinical pharmacist with Duke University Health System. Today, I will review the CDC guideline for prescribing opioids for chronic pain developed by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. This guideline was designed to focus on primary care doctors treating adult patients for chronic pain in an outpatient setting. Even though this guideline addresses primary care settings, I have seen these guidelines implemented in a wide range of outpatient settings. It is important to note that the guideline is not intended for patients who are in active cancer treatment, palliative care, or end-of-life care. What's great about these guidelines is that it focuses on providing practical recommendations that are feasible to implement in outpatient practices. Pharmacists should consider each of these recommendations and how they can play an active role in reinforcing this guideline in collaboration with prescribers. The CDC guideline was developed to improve the communication between doctors and their patients about the benefits and risks of using prescription opioids for chronic pain. The communication aspect should be emphasized. The patient should always be a part of the decision-making process, including having realistic expectations, goals, and be part of the reevaluation process. The CDC guideline also has a larger goal of providing safer, more effective care and reducing opioid use disorder and overdoses. Overall, the guideline provides 12 recommendations grouped into three categories to assist primary care clinicians in appropriately prescribing opioids to improve pain without compromising patient safety. The first category helps clinicians determine if and when to start prescription opioids for chronic pain. The second category gives guidance about medication selection, dose, and duration. This includes when and how to reassess progress, as well as how to discontinue medication if needed. The third category helps clinicians and patients together to assess the benefits and risks of prescription opioid use. As you can see, these categories address considerations that are commonly arise in daily practice. The first category we will review is determining when to initiate or continue opioids for chronic pain. The first recommendation is that non-pharmacologic therapy and non-opioid therapy are preferred for chronic pain. Clinicians should consider opioid therapy only if expected benefits for both pain and function are anticipated to outweigh risks to the patient. If opioids are used, they should be combined with non-pharmacologic therapy and non-opioid pharmacologic therapy as appropriate. It is important to continue to incorporate these other treatment modalities and ensure the patient recognizes the importance of the non-pharmacologic therapy and non-opioid therapy. Examples of non-pharmacologic approaches include physical therapy, weight loss, and cognitive behavioral therapy. This may require bringing in other specialists into a patient's pain management team. Some examples of non-opioid therapy include utilizing acetaminophen, NSAIDs, some antidepressants and anticonvulsants, and steroid injections. The selection of these non-pharmacologic and non-opioid treatment options should be based on the patient's medical history and disease state that is being treated. The second recommendation is to establish and measure progress towards goals. Realistic goals for pain and function should be set with the patient. If risks of opioid therapy begin to outweigh benefits, discontinuation should be discussed, including the details regarding how the opioid will be tapered off. Opioid therapy can be continued if there is a meaningful improvement in pain and function. The third recommendation is that a discussion takes place with the patient regarding realistic benefits and risks of opioid use. Examples of topics that can be discussed include function improving despite experiencing residual pain, common side effects, drug interactions, and short versus long-term efficacy of opioid treatment. The CDC notes that this conversation should be open and honest and a mutual decision between a patient and a provider. In addition, patient and clinician responsibilities should be defined and reevaluated at regular intervals. The next four recommendations fall under the category of opioid selection, dosage, duration, follow-up, and discontinuation. The CDC guideline recommends prescribing immediate release opioids when starting treatment. Extended release and long-acting formulations increase risk for overdose and do not have a better safety or efficacy profile compared to other formulations. There are additional cautions and risks associated with methadone, transdermal fentanyl, and immediate-release opioids combined with extended-release or long-acting opioids. Some of these risks include QTC prolongation and an increased risk of overdose with methadone compared to other opioids, and variable absorption associated with fentanyl patches, which can also lead to an overdose. Of note, the abuse-deterrent opioid formulations on the market can still potentially be abused through various routes of administration. The next recommendation is to use caution at any dose and avoid increasing to high dosages. The CDC recommends prescribing the lowest effective dose. In practice, ideally, this dose would continue to go down as function and pain improve. If the dose is greater than or equal to 50 morphine milligram equivalents per day, then reassess benefits and risks with the patient. Doses above 90 morphine milligram equivalents per day should be avoided. It is helpful to have an easily accessible opioid conversion table or calculator so the morphine equivalent can be determined quickly. The sixth recommendation is prescribing no more opioids than needed. It is important to remember that long-term use often begins with treatment of acute pain. In the scenario that a patient presents with acute pain that is appropriate for opioid therapy, use the lowest effective dose of the immediate-release formulation. 3 days or more of acute pain treatment is a sufficient duration of therapy, but more than 7 days is rarely needed. Extended release and long-acting formulations should be avoided in an acute pain management scenario as well. The final recommendation of this category is tapering if opioids cause harm or are not helping. It is recommended that timeframes are set up to evaluate risk versus benefit of opioid therapy. These timeframes occur at 1 to 4 weeks post-initiation, after any dose escalation, and every 3 months while on therapy. If it is determined that risks outweigh benefits, then providers can consider two approaches. The first is to taper to a decreased dose, and the second is to discontinue altogether, which may also require a taper. With either of these approaches, remember that other therapies should be optimized. We will now review the final category of assessing risk and addressing harms of opioid use. The eighth recommendation is to evaluate and address risks for opioid-related harm. An approach mentioned in the guideline is to incorporate a management plan strategy to mitigate risk. A more specific example of this is offering naloxone when factors that increase risk for opioid overdose, such as history of overdose, history of substance use disorder, higher opioid dosages, such as greater than 50 morphine milligram equivalents per day, or concurrent benzodiazepine use are present. Given the widespread availability of naloxone in community pharmacies, I have found it to be beneficial to write clinic-specific protocols detailing the logistics of patients acquiring naloxone. Remember to continually reevaluate patients for opioid overdose risk factors, as these can change over time. The ninth recommendation is to check controlled substance reporting systems for high dosages and dangerous combinations that can increase risk for overdose. Check prior to the start of treatment and at least every 3 months if therapy is continued. There are some reporting systems that link to other states, which can be beneficial for settings that have patients who travel from other states. In addition, clinic staff can be delegated in some controlled substances reporting systems so they can print the report and streamline the review process. The next recommendation is to test urine for prescribed opioids and other drugs. The CDC recommends completing urine drug testing before starting opioid therapy and consider urine drug testing at least annually to assess for prescribed medications as well as other controlled prescription drugs and illicit drugs. The urine drug screen is also helpful in revealing if the patient is not taking the medication when it is expected that the screen would test positive, which may indicate diversion. The 11th recommendation is to avoid concurrent opioid and benzodiazepine prescribing whenever possible. The combination of these two classes of medications can increase risks of an overdose. If they are prescribed together, involving a pharmacist and pain specialist should be considered. If it is decided that a patient will discontinue their benzodiazepine, remember that this can be tapered to prevent withdrawal symptoms. The 12th recommendation is to treat patients for opioid use disorder if needed. Links to services or medication-assisted treatment, such as buprenorphine or methadone, in combination with behavioral therapy should be offered. Referral information can be included in a protocol for efficient access when needed. The CDC guideline discusses bringing in additional team members, including pharmacists, in the development and provision of these opioid-related services. There are many roles where pharmacists can be involved. In the community setting, pharmacists can check the controlled substance reporting system, provide naloxone education, collaborate with local clinics, and remain vigilant about opioid diversion or misuse. Based on state laws, pharmacists can also utilize collaborative practice agreements to provide follow-up pain management visits for ongoing adherence to opioid guidelines. Pain management guidance and regulations are continuing to evolve at a fast pace, and as pharmacists, we should be prepared to address these changes in our individual practices. Thank you. Thank you.